before we dive into the scripture, let's pray once more. Heavenly Father, we come before your throne with reverence. We're going to encounter this one of this most sacred moment recorded in the scripture. Lord, I ask Holy Spirit, come to invade our hearts, open our eyes, let us see what you desire. Let us see a glimpse of your kingdom and of your heart. Help us, Lord. In your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. Today's topic is a different baptism. So for this sermon, I wanted to make it interactive. I want you to dive into the scripture with me and to understand what kind of differences there is between Jesus' baptism and our baptism. And to make it more lively, and I invite William and Justin to come to in front of us. So during the Christmas celebration, we have a gospel play titled Seven Miracles of Jesus. And Jesus' baptism was one of them. And during the gospel play, and they will play out how Jesus was baptized. I invite you to watch this play a little bit more and closely, and to see how Jesus' baptism is different from your baptism or the baptism you have witnessed.
Into us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore.
So this is the baptism in live illustration. Can you just tell me what kind of differences you observe between Jesus' baptism and your baptism? Anybody? Just call out. There's a dove. Right? There's a dove coming in. And from Holy Scripture, it says it's the Holy Spirit descended like a dove. What else? So let me, there are three differences. One is baptizer. The second one is baptized. And the third one is a testimony. So you know that during the baptism ceremony, there's a baptizer. Oftentimes the elder or the pastor. And the baptized, and many of you were baptized in this congregation, and so you were among the baptized. And then after baptism, you give testimony. And all these three aspects are different between Jesus' baptism and our baptism. And today, my prayer is that Holy Spirit will reveal to us a profound moment of Jesus' baptism that reveals the Father's heart to save you and me. And I won't give you, again, this is the interactive. I really want you to engage with the scripture. And so I will not give you all the answers. I want you to give me the answers first, and I'll tell you what are the differences. So let's first also, other than the gospel play, let's also read through the scripture once more. Just think about, okay, now I know those three things are different. How are they different? So engage with the scripture. So let's either read from the screen or from your pamphlet. Let's read once more. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? But Jesus answered, let it be so, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented. Then when Jesus was baptized, he immediately went from water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. Behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Can you go to the next slide? The next day, he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And this of whom I said, after me comes a man who before me, and because he was before me, after me comes, I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John bore witness, I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and remain on him. I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and have bore witness that this is the Son of God. This is the Word of God. So the first difference, the baptizer. What's the difference between the baptism in church and the Jesus baptism? What's the difference? Other than the baptizer was named John. And what's the difference? That's it. He wasn't willing, right? So the John Baptist wasn't willing. So the baptizer refused to do it. Does that blow your mind? Let's say you want to get baptized in this church, and you come to me and you give me your faith statement. I said, no, I'm not going to baptize you. And the reason, you see, not because that John the Baptist doesn't know how. John the Baptist, if you read the scripture in a few verses before, he knows how to baptize people. Matthew 3:5. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of Jordan, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. There were thousands of people come to him to be baptized. Certainly, Baptist John received his name and he's a professional baptizer. That's why he has this name. But this professional baptizer refused to give baptism to Jesus. And then, not because he was busy. He certainly was busy. There are thousands of people. But if you look at his mission statement, he said, I came baptizing in John 1:31 with water, so that he might be revealed to Israel. He definitely wanted to baptize people, so that Jesus may be revealed to Israel. So he was not too busy to baptize Jesus. So why did John refuse to give baptism to Jesus? And he himself gives that reason. He didn't feel that the baptized needed. And he said, I should come to you to be baptized. Why do you come to me? And to understand this statement, we have to understand what the baptism of John was. So if you read Matthew chapter 3, from the very beginning, Gospel John said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. So John's baptism is a baptism of repentance. So when he called people, he said, oh, like you brood of vipers. He was calling the Israel on their name to say, you sinners, come repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. So he called out to Israelites to say, you sinners, come repent to prepare for the way of the Lord. So when he called out the people, he had specific targets. But that time, when he saw Jesus, he certainly didn't count Jesus as one of them. So if you read on, he said, I need to be baptized you. Why do you come to me? And then here is the most revealing part. Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. So if you read the scripture, the Lamb of God takes away the sin. The Lamb of God is a symbol of sinless offering. So it can take away the sin of those that offering is supposed to atone. So ceremonial washing is nothing new in Old Testament. So if you look at the temple of God, there's a basin outside the holy, and then for the priests and others to wash. But this immersion, total immersion into Jordan River, is new in New Testament. And never before was mentioned in Old Testament, except that I think in the Second King, there's a general from Syria, and who got have this skin disease and a leper, and who were dipped into the Jordan River 7 times to get washed clean. But other than that, the ceremonial washing is only for hands. And here, Baptist John was sent to start this baptism with total immersion. But that immersion is only for repentance, for the sinners. So when Jesus went to him, he said, why do you come to me? I need to be baptized by you. And why do you come to me? So the baptizer refused to baptize. So John the Baptist is a prophet. He saw a lot of things that other people do not see. And he saw Jesus even before he was crucified and ascended into heaven. He knew this is the Son of God. So he said, I should be baptized by you. Why do you come to me? He certainly didn't count Jesus as one of the sinners. He said, you are Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So Baptist John doesn't think Jesus needed the baptism. So he refused to give him the baptism. And then the second difference came, the baptized. The baptized would give a reason, right? They need to be baptized. In our church, the baptized will, typically we ask 3 questions. The first one, are you a sinner? Do you confess you are a sinner? And secondarily, do you believe Jesus died for you and rose from the grave and ascended into heaven 3 days later? And the third question is, do you transfer the ownership of your life to Jesus? And when you say yes, and then the baptizer will baptize you. But here, the baptized gave a totally different reason for him to be baptized. What reason did he give? What reason did Jesus give? Anybody? Anybody? What reason did Jesus give that he needed to be baptized? Fulfill all righteousness. Thank you. So baptized gives a totally different reason. So what does fulfill all righteousness mean? Fulfill all righteousness. Fulfill means to bring to reality. So righteousness is the quality of being right or justified. So now, when Jesus went into the baptism, he fulfilled all righteousness. So you may ask, whose righteousness it was? What kind of righteousness is this? When Jesus went into baptism, that baptizer refused to give, he would fulfill all righteousness. And for this reason, and this reason alone, Baptist John decided to give him the baptism. So this reason must be very significant. Because previously, Baptist John did not want to baptize him. And by the way, Baptist John is not somebody who are easily swayed. For instance, he sacrificed his life by criticizing the king. He's not like mince his word. When he have some idea, he's going to give his life for it. He's not like wishy-washy, like this is okay, that is okay too. He's not that kind of people. When he said, you don't need to be baptized, he truly meant, I'm not going to baptize you. But when Jesus said, let it be, it is fitting for us to do that, to fulfill all righteousness. And this reason, and this reason alone, changed Baptist John's perspective. And what is this reason? Why Jesus receiving this baptism will fulfill all righteousness? So let's explore this a little bit and how this become the turning point of this baptism. It's best to use the scripture to understand the scripture. The 2 Corinthians 5:21. Let's read this. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Fulfill all righteousness, meaning we become righteousness. We become righteousness. I don't know about you, but me, let's say I just reflect on the things that I have done last week. There are a lot of things I may not be very proud of. The secret, like thoughts I have, either complaints or bitterness towards some people. And some complaints and even dark thoughts about certain things, So if we are truly honest to ourselves, we cannot call ourselves the righteousness of God. Not just righteousness, it's righteousness of God. But somehow, when Jesus became sin, we become righteousness. By accepting that baptism which belongs to sinners, the sinless God went into the river of Jordan side by side with other sinners. He became sin. So that other people who have sin can become righteousness. Every morning on Sunday, Fawn and I would pray and reflect on the message. While I was praying and reflect on the message, the weight of the scripture just struck me. Why? Let's suppose this scenario. Would it be easier for Jesus to be baptized right before his crucifixion, that he becomes sin and then crucified? Then he went into the ministry, becomes sin, and carry that mankind's sin on his shoulder, and doing all those miracles 3 years. If you look at the Jesus' baptism, it is one of the few events recorded in great detail in all four Gospels. Gospel Matthew, Gospel Mark, Gospel Luke, Gospel John. If you look, there's not many events recorded in great detail in all four Gospels. So this is of paramount importance to God. But why was Jesus baptized before he went into the ministry? He was sinless. Would it be easier for him to carry on the ministry without being baptized, without being contaminated by the sin? Will that be holier for the Lamb of God to perform the miracles, to heal the dead, heal the disease, and raise the dead with no sin that touch him? But that's not God's intention. God arranged Jesus to be baptized before he did any ministry, preach any sermon, heal any sick, raise any dead. He subject Jesus to the Jordan River to become sin. I was thinking about this moment Jesus went into the Jordan River. That is a sacred moment. Imagine this. An innocent man he declares himself guilty just to save the guilty one, willingly. That's the counterparts that we can relate. But after he called himself guilty, he went on to perform all the ministries, all the miracles, so that we might become the righteousness. What kind of righteousness? The righteousness of God. Not only his obedience fulfilled our righteousness, but his obedience also fulfilled God's righteousness. Because God's righteousness now become indwelled in us. So you and I manifest God's righteousness. Just think about that. You and I, who are saved, manifest, not only manifest, we are the righteousness of God. So the profound spiritual impact, that's seemingly easy submission or immersion into the Jordan River, is beyond my comprehension and grip, because it did something miraculous. His obedience at that point demonstrates his determination to die. He became sin and started to bear all the wrath of God. So I suddenly realized why God submit Jesus into this baptism of repentance before he sent him out to perform ministry. Because this way, Jesus now have the full understanding of you and me, what we go through, have gone through, and will go through as a sinner. But he knew no sin. He became sin. So he's fully aware of what sin's burden on us and what's the consequence of sin that separate him and God. And later on you are going to see, because of that, the dove, the Holy Spirit came. So God accomplished all this by making him to be sin, who knew no sin. The best way to illustrate this, I think, is through this. So this is a picture of 100 something people, inmates, who were executed and later on were exonerated and proclaimed innocent because they were executed wrongly. And the public outcry stems from those incidents. Every single one of them is a big public outcry for the injustice and for the kind of the justice need to be done. And there's about 100 some through the courts of U.S. law who were executed wrongly. And those were the inmates and who were innocent but executed. And people mourn for them. And people cry out for the justice to be done because they died wrongly. But if you look at Jesus, this is another picture, but a different kind of picture. So when Jesus went into Jordan River with Baptist John and said, "Let it be so, for it is fitting for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness." He's like, I will die. And I'm willing to die, even though I'm totally innocent. And this is a little bit different from the inmate being executed, in that A, the inmates were not willing to die, and B, the inmates were going to die anyway, regardless whether they are going to be executed or not, because we are all mortal beings. But here is different. When Jesus became flesh, he not only knew no sin, he knew no limit of life. So when he willingly walked into the Jordan River, he says two things. A, I'm willing to taste the sin, meaning touch sin. And B, I'm willing to taste death. God knows no limit. God has no boundary. God is not confined by the space or temporal constraints. He knows no bound. But at this moment, he came to say, "I want to die on behalf of the people who I'm going to save." He made him to be sin who knew no sin. The third difference, testimony. So when we are baptized, we will stand up, right, to do testimony. What God has done in my life to transform my life into a life that would be willing to follow and yield the lordship and the ownership to Jesus. When you look through the scripture, did Jesus say anything after baptism? Did Jesus himself give any testimony? Not recorded. So the scripture, however, so the testimony was not by Jesus. The testimony was by Holy Spirit and the Father God. So when Justin, I don't know how to do this. I'm not very good with this. When this dove came, that Holy Spirit descend, not only descend, remain. That's very important. Holy Spirit remained on Jesus. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, with whom I'm well pleased. We can only understand why both Holy Spirit and the Holy Father appeared at this moment if we understand the weight of Jesus carried. Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin. As soon as he went into this baptism, unlike our baptism, we came out free and alive, because our baptism symbolizes the old self has died and the new self has come. The Jesus baptism is like his eternal being has willingly give up. When he came up, he's to die. Unlike our joy, I would imagine the weight of the sin of the mankind start to weigh on him. And we said, God is love. And this Trinity God is love. And the love is manifested from this communal support. So when Jesus was carrying this huge weight of mankind's sin, past, present, and future on him, Holy Spirit came to encourage him, strengthen him. And then the Holy Father said, you are my son. Even though, because of this sin, on the cross, you and I may be separated briefly, but I'm well pleased with you. This is the love of God. Manifests itself in the true, relatable, that's you have buddies. When you are suffering, the best thing you can do is to spend time with them. And this is how the love of God and the love of Spirit manifest themselves. They spend time, they just be with the Holy Son. All right, what it means to us for this? So the Holy Spirit, he's revealing, he's descending also means that Jesus will baptize with Holy Spirit. So this one is become a reality during the Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descend like the tongues of fire on the church. And the Father God to reveal that Jesus is the Son of God to the people, because all the spiritual entities know that Jesus is the Son of God, but the mortal beings do not. By speaking in an audible voice, humans start to understand that Jesus is the Son of God. All right, what it means to us? I don't know about your spiritual walk with God. But through this, today's message, and through the scripture, Jesus willingly going to Jordan River to receive the baptism for sinners, to demonstrate his willingness to carry your sin and mine. I don't know whether you are mad with God, you are indifferent with God and just think that he's a God of somebody who doesn't care about you. I urge you to reconcile with the Father God through Spirit in Christ. Because Jesus was sent by the Father God for our salvation. And this scripture says, this is love. While we are still sinners, Jesus died for us. So if you still think that this God does not exist or doesn't care about you, and when we go into, previously when we go to the Dare to Share, a lot of people are agnostic. They think God is indifferent. God doesn't care. He may exist, but he doesn't care about you. That cannot be further from truth. God cares. God cares so much. He sent his beloved Son to redeem you and me. So if there's any issue you are still working through with the God Father, today is opportunity just to come to him, openly say, God, reveal your loving heart to me so that I can get a glimpse of what a good Father you are. And the second one, just our idea of why we got baptized. I want everybody to leave this message knowing we receive baptism not to model after Jesus. Our baptism is fundamentally different from Jesus. We receive baptism not because Matthew 3 or John 1. We receive baptism because of Matthew 28. Because Jesus said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. That's why. We obey Jesus. So make sure that is right in your mind. The third one, I would say, probably the most personal to me. So this year, while I was reflecting on this verse, God just struck this verse so hard on my heart. It's John 13:34. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, you are to love one another. This is not a trivial verse. We need to love each other as Christ loved us. How did he love us? He loved us by sacrificing his life. So previously, I think I care about people, and I do my best to care, to love. But this verse challenged me to love sacrificially, not conveniently. And I urge you, God's people and this congregation, to love sacrificially. And a few kind of things you can do. One, sacrifice half an hour of sleep on Sundays and come here early and wait on God. And our worship starts at 10, and at 10 o'clock there's very few people here. So if you can sacrifice half an hour on Sunday morning, that's not a lot to ask, but it's one way to show our reverence and obedience to the Lord by waiting on God. And the second one is, if there's anybody God bring to your mind to love and to care, love them by sacrificing your time, your energy, to love them. And so this one, I think, is something I need to work on. I start to really examine my schedule and my heart. I want to love sacrificially this year. And I urge you to do the same. If we love conveniently, that's not really how Jesus loved us. Jesus did not love us conveniently. If it's convenient to him, he would get baptized right before crucifixion. That's how I would, because that makes my life much cleaner, much easier. We all work through our own spiritual walk and our daily struggles. But sacrificial love is something non-negotiable. It's a commandment from Jesus. And I pray in the new year, you and I, together, with the help of Holy Spirit, to love each other and love the community sacrificially. Let's pray. Holy Father, as we come to you with all thanksgiving and grateful praise, we just ask you to invade our hearts with your Spirit, with your Holy Spirit, to really fill our heart with your love, peace, joy, patience, faithfulness, goodness, gentleness, goodness, and self-control. And Lord, that we want to love, but oftentimes we cannot do it ourselves, and ask your Holy Spirit to help us to love, and to love sacrificially. Help us, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.